Okay, good morning, everyone. I think we're going to go ahead and get started. I want to welcome everyone to the annual debris management preparedness meeting. We're doing this both virtually and in person this year, and we had over 140 registrants, so thank you for that strong attendance. I can't believe that it's time to talk about hurricane preparedness again. It just seems like November just happened. They promised us a very busy season last year. It really didn't materialize. We had, you know, a little bit in the beginning and a big bang at the end. This year they're telling us, or what I'm reading, is that it's going to be a very complicated forecast, El Niños and high surface water temperatures, and you know how those might cancel one another out. So who knows what that'll mean, but based on the attendance today, I think we'll be ready for whatever might come our way. I want to recognize a few people with me today. I got Mr. Paul Gonzalez here. He's our Director of Customer Service. Many of you may remember John Archambo, who was his predecessor. He's joined the ranks of the retired, and Paul has taken over. Paul will be responsible in the event of a storm. First of all, let me introduce myself. My name's Patrick Carroll. I'm the Chief Operating Officer here at Solid Waste Authority, and in the event of a storm, I'm also act as the Emergency Management Coordinator and direct the response of the SWA. Paul would be my right-hand man in that instance, and he would be directing most of the field operations. Over here to my right, we have Willie Puz, who's our Legislative Coordinator and Public Relations. He will be one of two persons that will be manning the EOC for the SWA. And then Don White, who is our Risk Management Director, he will also be alternating with Willie at the EOC in the event of a storm. We have Karen Cantor. She's part of our Special Programs Group. And Karen supports us in getting the pre-authorized sites authorized with DEP. And she also helps us with a number of other regulatory issues that may come up as far as any kind of debris management activities. On the phone, we also have representatives from Thompson, who's our consultant. They'll be available after to answer any questions that may come up that might be something that we can't handle. They're pretty well versed in everything, both Florida and nationwide. We also have in attendance today representatives from Ashbritt. Could you stand up, Ashbritt? And that's just to put a face to a name. They're one of our debris haulers. And Phillips and Jordan. I think we also have some representatives from Phillips and Jordan. So we're going to talk a little bit about contracts. And you know, if any of you don't already have contracts, the contracts that we have in place are available to be piggybacked. And if you had any questions, detailed questions, you could certainly talk to these gentlemen after the presentation, and I'm sure they'd be more than willing to give you all kinds of good information. So for a lot of you veterans out there, you know, you're not going to see a lot of new stuff. This stuff doesn't really change. You know, we're going to talk about kind of the same stuff that we've talked about in past years. For some of the newer folks, hopefully you'll pick up a tidbit or two. This is our agenda for today's presentation. We're going to talk a little bit about what our priorities are after a storm. We're going to talk a little bit about the interlocal agreements that we have with all of the 39 municipalities and some special districts within the county. These are critical in establishing the relationship that allows you to participate in our debris management and debris recovery program. We're going to talk a little bit about truck certifications, placarding, very important in, obviously, in keeping track of those volumes and getting paid. Our contracts that I just mentioned, we'll go over those just real briefly. Pre- and post-storm communications, planning and response. We'll show you or outline the pre-approved debris management sites. We have 10 sites in the county that are pre-approved and permitted. We won't use all of those in the event of every storm. It'll largely depend on the magnitude of the storm. And all of our haulers also have private sites that they bring to the table should we need those. So we'll talk a little bit about that. The load ticketing process, we're gonna talk a little bit about, Paul's gonna talk about some of that. Any of you who are still using paper, try to get out of that habit. I think this is gonna be the last year that we're gonna allow paper tickets. We're really trying to push everyone to go to electronic just because of the speed and accuracy in which it allows us to provide you with feedback information. We'll talk a little bit about collecting debris in gated communities. This is a topic that we've talked about every single year, but it remains kind of a hot topic every time there's a storm. And again, we'll just put out the contact information for all of the SWA contacts so that, if some question comes up after today or some detail, you can feel free, obviously, to give any of us a call, and we'll be happy to provide you with the answer to your questions. So, fairly obvious, I guess, but our first priority post-storm is to reestablish garbage collection, regular garbage collection, utilizing our regular haulers, not our debris haulers. That typically can happen, again, it's all depending on the severity of the storm, but that typically happens, within a week or two at worst. And we're going to put all of our energy into that initially, followed quickly by, a campaign to begin the debris management. So obviously, we're asking you to ask your residents to separate at the curb to the best of their abilities, garbage, veg, and then mixed, and they'll be collected in that order. Garbage, veg, and then mixed would be last in terms of where our focus will be post-storm. I talked a little bit about the interlocal agreements, and those are very important. They establish the rules of the road, right? So it outlines the relationship between SWA and the municipalities, and again, the special districts that are involved that allows you to use one of our temporary debris management sites. It covers financial responsibilities, reimbursement, how all that works, who's responsible for what. And as I said, we do have one of these in place with all 39 municipalities and several special districts. So I think everybody in this room, as far as the interlocals, probably, I think, should be covered. If there's any questions on anything in there, you probably should, review those at the beginning of the year, beginning of the season. And if there's any questions or if any of the contact information for the people involved has changed, please let us know. We don't want to be sending blast fax or emails to somebody who retired a year ago, Next is the pre-hurricane season truck certs. Again, this is something that we've talked about every single year. It's super important. It's something that you can scratch off your list early, right? So for all of you municipalities and districts that are using the same trucks year over year, even if they've been certified in previous years, you need to get them recertified every year, okay? And the placarding process, it's simple, and we've established a couple of dates where staff from Thompson is going to come in, and they're going to they'll certify and placard any of the trucks that you bring. And so those dates this year are going to be Tuesday, June 6th, and that'll be at the landfill facility right down the street. On your left as you're going south at the landfill entrance, there'll be signs there. They'll be there all day, basically, from 9 to 3. And then the following day, they'll be at our Central County Transfer Station at Lantana and 95. Same schedule. And then if we need to, we can add Thursday. So please reach out to us. I know that they also have, Thompson has appointments and projects set up with some of the cities individually to do their trucks. So they'll be in town pretty much all week. But that's just something that's super simple to do. And, it's so you don't have to, in the event when the storm hits, you're not sitting in line with all of these guys from out of town trying to get your trucks placarded. this is just some close-up shots of that process. I mean, again, I'm sure most of you guys are pretty familiar with it. It's pretty straightforward and only takes a few minutes. So the debris removal contracts that I mentioned, we rebid those last year in 2022. We had, some of you may remember, we had six before. Now we have four. And those are three-year contracts with a three-year option, so 6 years total. They are on our website. They are available to be reviewed. They are also available to be piggybacked. If you don't already have one in place, I would suggest that you talk to one of those vendors. And these are the four. This was done through a competitive process, and this was the four that were selected in the order in which they were ranked. So Ashbrook, Crowder Golf, Phillips Jordan, and DRC Emergency Services. So again, contracts are available. A couple of these guys are here today. So if you have any questions, you know, please feel free. Thompson Consulting, again, we have reselected them for another 3+3. They do a great job. They're super knowledgeable guys, and they have really, yeah, I can't say enough good things about them. They've gotten us through a lot of tough situations and been our partners in a lot of storm events. Communications. So pre-storm, you know, most of the normal routes, the normal channels, we, you know, we'll use the news. Willie, you know, will be putting out press releases with the latest, greatest on our status. Once the storm center, or once the EOC is activated, we'll be using the web EOC system. I'm sure most of you are familiar with that. After the storm, we typically get into a mode where we're doing conference calls with specific groups, League of Cities, even some individual towns, you know, maybe West Palm, some of the bigger cities. But we can do that with pretty much anybody who needs it or wants it. And then, you know, ultimately, we'll transition into, you know, the cleanup mode where we'll have a special website set up where you can, you know, you can track where the first pass is, second pass, third pass. You can see what's been hit, what's been not, what's yet to come, and you can give your residents kind of an idea of when they can expect to be collected. So as far as the planning process goes, I mean, the key number for us is 40 miles per hour, tropical storm force winds. I'm sure this is very similar to the guidelines that all of you follow, but you know, we have the high profile tractor trailers, so we want to get them off the road, you know, really before it hits 40. So when a tropical storm warning is issued, that's when we're really buttoning things up. We're closing the facilities, getting our trucks off the road. All collections will stop. The transfer stations will be closed. Then we'll ride out the storm. Just like all of you, you know, as soon as we can, we'll be out there doing, you know, our reconnaissance, you know, checking all of our facilities for damage, and getting those open for business. And then, you know, immediately following that, we'll start the placarding process for trucks, and then we'll be getting the temporary debris management sites opened. Again, you know, we have the county well covered in terms of geographically located debris sites. We're a little bit weak in the North County area, but other than that, we have good coverage. We won't activate all of them, but we do, you know, try to make sure that the ones that we do open are in strategic locations, you know, depending on, again, the severity of the storm, which part of the county's been hit maybe the hardest, you know, some of the higher density areas, you know, higher population density areas. And, you know, traditionally, we've been able to have those sites open within 48 hours. We say 3 to 5 days, but we have been able to do better than that in most storms, or at least in the last, you know, 15 years that I've been involved. So this is a list of the sites, and Paul's going to jump in here and talk a little bit about this and collection in private communities, and then I'll come in and we'll handle questions at the end.
Good morning. Good morning. No, we got to do better than that. Good morning. As Patrick said, my name is Paul Gonsalves. There I have a lot of familiar faces out there, but if you've ever seen my name come across your email inbox, as most of you like to call me, Gonsalves, it's actually Gonsalves, but we'll move on. These are, like Patrick said, these are a list of our 10 debris sites. Depending on the severity of the storm, we would activate them as needed, as well as we have some of our contracted debris haulers out there who also bring private debris sites. And if we needed to activate those, we would, and we would make those known as they were activated. We request any municipality who have their own potential debris sites that they're going to activate to give us a list as well as a contact for that debris site. And if you're one of the municipalities who plan to use one of our sites, we ask that you make that known. For one, we need to know who's going to be using our sites. Two, we just need to make sure that you get your vehicles either pre-certified through the period that Patrick spoke about or immediately following the storm. There is a pre-authorization process for the debris sites. There's the website there below that can, if you want to activate a site, we also have Karen Cantor, who could be a point of contact and help you through that process. The preferred low-ticket system that we use is the electronic system. If you're one of those folks that still have a landline, or if you do have a cell phone that has a retractable antenna, paper is also available. So, but like Patrick said, this is the last year for that. This is just an example of one of our electronic low tickets. Like I said before, it's strictly optional. It's very convenient. The debris monitors that we use, Thompson, their system is compatible. If you have another debris monitor that has an electronic low ticket system, then they will be able to work with each other. This is a list of the different municipality codes. If you're gonna use our sites, when you start to get your low tickets, make sure that your prospective municipality code is correct on your ticket, so that way you're credited for your tonnages and your debris. There's not going to be any changes to how we operate the load and debris site monitoring. There was an issue previously where some of either the municipality's loads were being credited to the county or vice versa, but we have corrected, or Thompson has corrected that issue since then. If you are using Thompson, Thompson will capture the municipal codes on all the load tickets to track the inbound debris. Thompson's disposal tickets, what they'll do is they'll tie their disposal tickets to your municipal low tickets with a photograph. If you're using Thompson, Thompson will provide disposal activity reports. If you have a different monitor, you should provide data from your monitoring firm to Thompson, and then Thompson will reconcile this data with theirs weekly. But if you're using Thompson, there's no reconciliation needed. Gated communities or private roads. Generally, FEMA does not reimburse for these. Applicants must have a legal responsibility for storm debris removal on public roads. And to do this, you have to have a public need determination by either health, safety, or economic recovery. If you meet these guidelines, then you must seek approval from FEMA before entering the community. Some of the documentation that you can use to help through this process is letters from your county administrator, police, fire, health department, or school district. Now, when you seek approval from FEMA, just make sure that you indemnify FEMA as required in Section 407B of the Stafford Act. The Palm Beach County Post Disaster Debris Recovery Ordinance, we have language in that in Section 3 that helps us show that we have the legal responsibility for storm debris removal, as well as our mandatory collection resolution 2006-03 and Section 5 of that. And both of these you can be found on the SWA website. Within the post-disaster recovery ordinance, the language that we have is we have to implement a county emergency management plan in the event of a storm. And then we will collect and remove the disaster debris from public and private roads in unincorporated Palm Beach County for the purposes of eliminating immediate threat to life, public health, and safety. Also, we have amended our mandatory collection resolution 2006 to include the collection of disaster debris, right of entry, and indemnification of FEMA. With that, I'll turn it back over to Patrick.
Okay. So these are just, again, contact information for myself, Paul, Karen, Don, Willie, all of the folks that I introduced in the beginning. This presentation, by the way, it'll also be available on the website. So if you can't get all this information right now, don't worry about it. You can look it up later. But, you know, again, please feel free to call us with any question, any inquiry about anything. If we don't know, we'll find the answer for you. And again, the contacts for the contracts are also on the website. And this is just Paul and I. Again, in the event of a storm and post-storm, you know, we'll be the two guys that will be primarily directing traffic here for SWA. And there'll be, obviously a ton of other people involved. But and that's really it. We're going to go ahead and address questions. What I like to do is if there's anybody in the live audience, we'll start with you and then we'll see if anybody online has any questions and take it from there. Everybody knows everything that they need to know. All right. I can always count on Richard to ask a question. Go ahead.
Thank you. You mentioned that we had four debris removal contracts in place. As far as the debris management sites, are those managed also by those four contractors?
They would be.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Just wondering.
You getting anything online?
Yes. We have a question from Cody Hayes, and he's asking when the registration dates are to have the trucks inspected and receive placards.
I think they just need to show up on those days. They don't need to pre-register for that, so just show up. There will be signage at the landfill and at the transfer station that will direct them where they need to go and get there early and get in line. Hopefully they'll be through quickly.
What are the dates that that's taking place?
That was the 6th and the 7th and the 8th, yeah. The 6th at the landfill, the 7th Wednesday, the 7th at Central County Transfer Station, and then the 8th is not set in stone at this point. That's a overflow if we need it. Anything else? No? Yes, sir. I'm not sure I understand your question, but if there's the 10 sites that we have, those we pre-authorize those every year. If you have your own site, if you're from a municipality and you have your own site, you're responsible for getting that pre-authorized. We can help you. We can give you advice just because we've done it a lot. We can give you the contacts and the information that you need, but we're not doing it for you. You have to do it yourself. And yes, it does have to be done every year.
We just have to provide you with the list of sites, correct?
And contact.
Yeah. We would appreciate it if you're going to have your own site that you would give us that information. Yeah. Yeah, Karen, go ahead.
Karen.
Site that
Karen, sorry to have you repeat yourself, but for the benefit of the people online, can you please say that all again?
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, if you, as a municipality, have your own debris management sites and they have been previously authorized, then you should receive a notice from the Florida DEP that pre-authorization has opened, and they typically send instructions for that. But you can also go to their website as well, or to the portal where you actually conduct that activity, and you can just see if that's available and open. Thanks.
Okay, great, thank you, Karen. Anybody else? Yeah, go ahead.
And also, on the pre-certification process, just make sure the vehicles that
here, use the,
you
use
to get placard.
During the pre-certification process, the vehicles that you're bringing to get placard, I know some people will use subcontractors. Make sure that is a legit collection vehicle. I know we've all seen them, the dump trucks with the missing rear door, with the extended wood on the side to try to increase their capacity. Those will not get certified. They have to be truck, they have to be roadworthy trucks, and they have to be a normal collection vehicle. So just keep that in mind as well.
Okay, you got anything else online?
If nothing else online.
If we don't have any other questions, that's all we have today. I want to thank you guys all for coming, and let's hope for a quiet one, but let's be prepared for a busy one if we need to be. Thank you.